always start with a prize act. She always surprises me anyway. This lady, we go back quite a bit because we both worked in Waterford Crystal, and that's when we came to know each other first. And I'm not saying how many years ago, because she's only 25. She was underage working, you know. And, yeah, child labor. Yeah, that's right. But she wouldn't have even gotten a job there only for her father.
That's true.
But enough of that old black arrogance. Like, I'd like to introduce you to somebody I respect hugely, and I love very much, Lynda Gough.
Okay, this is a memoir piece about my father, Joe Gough is his name. Some people might have heard it before, some people might have known my dad, I don't know, but forgive me if you've heard it before. It's a memoir piece that I need to really actually go back to because I've been reading it so much that I need to actually finish it. So this is a piece about my father's, what I call the final journey. So my sister, who's here tonight all the way from Australia, and her son Zach, who is a product of the wedding, which I'm going to talk about here tonight. So this is Joe's final journey, okay? So I hope you enjoy it. My sister Janet's wedding became the fullest production that our father Joe undertook. She announced her engagement to Jer in 2003. They were to marry a year later. Enough time for Joe to organize the venue, church, bands, and the guests, all of which he took upon himself. Janet's list of 80 guests grew larger by the weeks, and Joe's trips to the bookie office saw him invite all and sundry. He updated her daily from the kitchen phone extension, resting his large frame against the jamb of the door, his list of names sprawled before him. Janet's fiancé, Jared, with his quiet nature, could not hold back the driving engine that was Joe. As the production grew, Jer's fears expanded. The cost was the main concern. Joe calmed his panic by insisting on paying. The credit union hadn't let him down yet. The tussle of numbers finally stopped at 120. Next to tackle was the band. Who have we lined up for the night, Jenny? The butterfly band, Dad. The who? The buttercup. I never heard of them, Jenny. No, butterfly, Dad. Butterfly. Oh, they sound loud. Mrs. O'Neill's here and they'll be set off. Daddy, they play modern music. No waltzes. I'm sure they'll play if you ask, Dad. Oh, that's not a proper band if you have to ask. Jer and me like him, Dad. I know, honey child. But Mrs. O'Neill and Josie next door won't. Jesus, Dad, you're driving me mad. You're getting fussy on me now, Jimmy. He knew her pet name would soften her. I was thinking about Dick and Mick, Jan. They're ancient, Dad. But they're great musicians. Sure, Dick played with Hal Roach. Oh. Hal Roach, the best in the country, Jan. Went to America and he had a great career. Yeah, Dad, but Dick is still here. All the better, Janny, we can book him. The sitting room floor filled up with glossy bride-to-be and fabric samples. Joe watched the telly, one eye on the cowboy action and one on his girls. Rita was his queen, our mother. He adored and he had fought for her. Rita was engaged when they met. Her reason for changing her mind was buried in his strength of character. His softness and kindness to his mother swung it in his favour. Joe saw it more like a shootout. He was John Wayne. I put the run on him, went to England and was never seen again. Stop it, Joe. Rita blushed every time. I got the black beauty. 40 years of marriage now brought them both to the marriage of their youngest child. I would never marry, nor tell them out straight why. The many years of tomboy looks were telling in itself. The line of past boyfriends stopped at age 23, replaced by friends who looked like me. I was sporting crew cuts and baggy jeans, defeminized and shouting at the world. A product of my 1970s environment had kept my lips sealed. Joe and Rita would have accepted, and in their own way they did. To me, I was the failure. My buried secret kept them out. Rita buffered neighbours' comments to one side.
Understand Lynn getting married now, Rita?
Oh, no, 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 Miss Sunil. Lynda wants a career. Oh, does she now, girl? In what? In the theatre, Mrs. O'Neill.
Oops. God, the theatre's full of puffs.
It might be Miss O'Neill, but Lynda likes it. Best of luck to her now, but you do need children, Rita. She's too young to be thinking about that, Mrs. O'Neill.
So many opportunities I left slip by, and Janet's pressing eyes I tried to avoid.
Mum and Dad watched the soaps, Lynn.
I know, but they watched Brookside, and it has a lesbian storyline. Well, you can tell them when I go back to Dublin. You need to tell them yourself, Lynn.
By this time, I was in a 15-year relationship with my girlfriend. Linda's friend, Breach, had been accepted with open arms and was even roped in by Joe to do the video for the wedding. Joe's final announcement, 2 weeks before the big day, set his female flock flying.
I have a little song I'd like to sing, Janny.
What is it, Dad?
Oh, what a beautiful morning, Jan.
Oh, Dad, from Oklahoma.
The very one, honey child. His tenor voice fills the sitting room.
Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way.
We finished the line in family unison. What do you think, girls? Flushed with emotion, we agreed it was perfect. Just as we're coming up the aisle, I'll start singing, and we should be well finished by the time we reach Jer. Janet's emotion turned to torrents of tears.
No, Dad, no, nobody does that. But I'd like to do that for you, Janny.
For the first time in years, I saw Joe cry. He never let convention wedge its way into his love for us. His gift of song was his currency. Wounded by the rebuff, he went to his shed. Rita joined him. Slowly she restored his pride. With gentle negotiations, she brought him back up the garden and back to the wedding plans and back to us. 17th of April, the day had arrived. Months of marriage talk and preparation exploded into a flurry of neighbours. Oh, gorgeous, beautiful. Oh, she's like a model. Oh, Joe, the purple cravat brings out your eyes. Rita, you're only magnificent, son.
Figure.
Lynn,
the lace is so delicate. It's surely gorgeous in a dress.
The vintage white Rolls Royce with its purple satin ribbons pulled up onto the yellow road. Joe sat up the front, quizzing the chauffeur on every little part of the engine. The journey to Knockby Church was only hindered by an unexpected cortege, giving Joe even more time to explore the car. This was the last car he sat in beside his own. 5 months later, we followed a different cortege. August 19, 2004, he backed his last hopefuls. In the bookie office, his huge heart stopped. His lucky lotto stars tucked into his John Wayne denims. Knockby Church could not hold back the crowd. Not one voice was quiet as we all joined in his song.
Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way.
Thank you.
I'm still wearing my Christmas tie, as you can see, because you know, men never grow up. We tend to hold on to quiet things. I'm still waiting for Santa to bring me the present. I prayed to Santa for the present and I didn't get it. But the song's next year.
Yeah.
We'll go on to the second act. This is somebody that I also know for quite a long time. I met him first up in Milan's pub in Newgate Street, where he sang, and he's still singing and playing the guitar beautifully. And I'd like to introduce you to Paul Dillon.